All right. Once begun is half done. You're already half done once you've begun. I spent five. It took me 5 hours this morning to get out of bed. The blowback, backlash from the success that I've been having is so strong that literally I had to work and meditate for 5 hours just to get out of bed. This is how it goes. A full stop in the wow. The way I pulled out of it was a full stop in the wow, and I started working on it, and then started. That gave me the focus to realize I was just in a severe wow, shock of the wow, and I was able to then gradually work through it and get back to the clarity I had during the taping, and dissipate, evaporate a lot of this fear. Disc-free space. Okay, we have a lot of disc-free space here, so we're fine. We're fine. Now, I liken the spiritual path to being like a studio musician. Studio musicians often start work at like about 9 o'clock in the morning, and they often work till midnight, at least in the old days, 15-hour days, and they get paid a union scale. Some of them said they made like $100 a day back in the 60s, 70s, but they don't get any credits for the records, no royalties whatsoever. None whatsoever. But they're the ones who actually do all the work, most of the work, really. The house band of these recording studios, they actually do a lot of the arranging and producing of the song. They bring it to life. Often they'll come in with just some lyrics and a couple of chords. They're the ones who actually, you know, compose the song in a lot of ways. And they make it sound good. And they don't get any credit for it. Well, and yet they're immersed in this every day. It's a job. They come in and they make this beautiful music, but it's a job, and they're super good at it. So we, on the spiritual path, we have to be like studio musicians, actually, and not worry about those stars that are running around getting attention and money, you know, pretending to be, you know, spiritually in tune or whatever they're doing. We don't get the recognition, we don't get the fame and the fortune, we don't get any of that. But what we do is we get better and better and better and better and better at this. And we spend a lot of time at it. Let's see. This is how it goes on the spiritual path. You have to be a professional. You have to immerse yourself in it. You have to be engaged with it all the time. All the time engaged with it. You're not a star. The problem with the world now is they're obsessed with being stars. It's called empowerment. Empowerment. We're empowering you to be a star. Well, what are they not doing? They're not doing any of this session work that we're doing, are they? And there's no way you're going to get enlightened without doing this session work, okay? You'll just be a poser. You know, and you'll just simply have a clever contrivances, which is, we're tired of worshiping clever contrivance, false creativity. We've honored it enough. You know, sure, we honored it because it's part of our creativity. Being, you know, clever contrivance, camouflaging arrogance is part of our creativity. But we've done enough of that, more than enough of that. Now it's time to move on from that. So you have to get down and do the session work. For example, these stars with their bands, their glamorous bands, everybody's up there, people are saying, oh yeah. And you say, hey, that doesn't sound like the record. You know, and it's kind of like disappointed. It doesn't really sound as good as the record. That's weird. That's because the musicians that are playing on all these stars' records, those are the house bands of the studio. They're not the touring band. They're not the touring band. And of course it doesn't sound as good. So, you know, when you're paying attention to some of these stars that are running around and not doing the session work, that may not be the best thing for you. It's better for you to say, hey, I'm a lifer. You know, I'm a lifer. I'm into spiritual clarification. That's what I'm into. And I'm just a lifer. That's what I do. That's what I do. And then just do it. Really, really, really great. And listen to the inner teacher, the inner savior, the inner guru. There is an inner guru. And this inner guru takes on aspects that we call spiritual teachers, enlightened gurus in the world that come in, but they all come from the same source. They all come from the same source, actually, which is the inner guru. Judeo-Christian traditions call it the Holy Spirit is the inner guru. That's the term that's used. This inner guru knows all. It knows all. Okay, and it's really us. We're omniscient, actually. But we're arrogantly denying this. So this inner guru, we ask this inner guru for help, actually, which is what I did this morning. I said, hey, inner guru, I really need some help. I mean, meditation master. I need a meditation master to help me. And lo and behold, I got the help I asked for. And it was quite something, quite something. We all have this within us. Just like those studio musicians, where do they get the talent? I mean, these people, you look at them, they're nondescript, a bunch of white men, actually, lumpy white men. They're not charismatic. They look kind of geeky. They're music geeks. But the creativity and taste that they had is extraordinary. And the capacity to sort of play as one mind there, one creative mind with these different, like all these different arms playing these instruments, is extraordinary. Listening to those songs that they played on, for instance, in the 60s, 70s, and 80s, and it's changed a little bit these days, but back then, as a musician, you listen to that, I was amazed, I'm still amazed, how creatively tasteful. And you look at the guys playing it, and you walk them by on the street and you say, there's some dumb redneck or who's, you know, you wouldn't give them a moment's notice. Okay, you wouldn't give them a moment's notice. But wow, do they have the inner creativity to cut four sides a day? I mean, they had to cut four sides a day, meaning back then they had singles of one side and the A side, the B side, and basically four songs a day by these major, you know, by these stars. And they have to make those songs hits, make them hits, so people will listen to them and say, this is a great song. Four a day, the pressure they're under, four a day. So for us, we have to access the inner meditation master who gives us these insights, maybe four great insights a day. You know, this is the kind of pressure I've been under. I put myself under this kind of severe pressure. But sometimes the hit is so strong that you can't play anymore. You know, imagine if you're a session musician and you're playing a song, and you get this song and you lay the tracks down, and you listen to it and you say, oh my gosh, this is a number one hit without any question. This is just going to be a monster, huge hit. And you may end up just being like almost like enthralled by just how great it sounds, and you have a hard time cutting any other songs that day. it's quite similar to that, actually. You're stunned by your own creativity, actually. And so this is a problem that you run into, and you have to be very, very disciplined. Very, very disciplined, a full stop in the wow. I don't even go back and listen to my tapings because I know it's going to stun me. I'm already stunned by taping it. So that's enough. I don't want to hear it. So as a real good studio session player, you might not even want to hear the finished song. Just say, look, I know we cut it, you know, did a really good job, and we got it the next one we gotta do. So don't even listen to it. I call it full stop in the wow. It is just temper down this elation and trepidation. It's like, oh wow, we're really making great success, or this is going to be a big hit. Just temper it down. Okay, let me temper this down a little bit here. The lighting here. Because, you know, it's getting to the point where the insights now are so fundamental and so just aware, oh my gosh, you know, this is just, we're getting into some very fruitful territory here, to say the least. And the key is to normalize it in your own mind, So you don't really shrug it off. And it's amazing, these session musicians, they say, yeah, I played on this song, this song, this song, this song. I say, wait a minute, those are some of the greatest hits ever. And they just, yeah, it was fun. It was fun. I asked Glenn Campbell once, I met Glenn Campbell. I asked him, hey, how was it playing on the Beach Boys sessions? And he said, yeah, that was a lot of fun. That's a lot of fun. And that was it. And then he shrugged it off. I won't tattle on Glenn. He had a rough, some ups and downs for sure. But that, his attitude, what I want to see, what was his attitude like? You know, he played on some of the greatest hits ever. He's a big superstar himself. And he just kind of shrugged and said, yeah, that was a lot of fun. That's a lot of fun. And then he just moved right on. That's it. I said, wow. Okay, that's interesting. That's a good attitude to have, I see. Don't let the wow overwhelm you. So I say, manage the wow, full stop on the wow. The wow has to be managed. So I say, two keys to success is, one, stay engaged with the spiritual path as much as possible. Be like a session musician. House band, you're part of the house band. Two, manage the wow factor. That we're making, you know, getting into very fruitful territory here. Understanding the advice of the inner meditation master. You know, whether you want to call it Buddha, Longchenpa, Jesus, Ramana Maharshi, Ananda Maima, Nisargadatta Maharaj, Punja Ji, you know, there's thousands of names you can put, Krishna, you can call thousands of names, whatever you want to call it, it's the inner master, okay, the inner meditation master, and we're getting advice and we're applying it, and this is fruitful territory, and so of course we're going to have the wow reaction, but I'm trying to dampen it down, saying, hey, come on, it's the backlash, it stuns me. It's quite stunning. I think we might get a slight interruption here coming up. But okay. Did not get too much of an interruption here, because I told them ahead of time I'm going to be taping here. It's like studio session players. It's business. I mean, they're getting paid. They're working. You don't want to have a whole bunch of hangers-on around. You don't. Then the whole scene gets all too loose, and then drugs enter the scene, and it gets to be a bad scene. No, these people were, you know, you're dedicated, and you're serious about making a hit record, and you got to really be focused in on it, you know, creativity, but not foolishness. So we're interested in being enlightened, absolutely, we're interested, very keen on it, and we're doing it. But we have to maintain this focus, middle pathness of avoiding extremes of this way or that way, staying full stopness, I would call it, full stopness, neutralness, is trying not to get, you know, this way too much or that way too much in terms of our reactions. We're not searching for a middle ground, we're taking a middle path. There's a big difference between the two terms and the meaning of that. Sure, we're being creative, we're brainstorming, but like I say, there's three parts to it. There's assertions, full stop, and the wow, flipping the script. There's those three aspects to the path, and we kind of shift between them and try to stay, you know, on this middle path. It's very narrow. In Judeo-Christian tradition, it's the narrow, straight and narrow path. Well, it may not seem to be so straight because we're kind of shifting this way and that way, but it's very narrow path. You don't want to go into extremes. First, as in Buddhism, Buddha's whole point was don't go into the extremes of trying to develop trance states, nor trying to mortify the flesh. Austerities, you know, self-mortification of the flesh. Don't go into either one of those extremes. there's a way to get to it without veering off into extremism. Okay, and this is the same thing as the straight and narrow way. We don't veer off into extremism. We're certainly not trying to develop trance states, nor are we trying to mortify the flesh here. What we are doing is we're staying engaged. Now, we have to ask advice from the inner meditation master, okay? And call it what you want. And I got some advice this morning. After a great deal of meditation and flipping the script, trying to get back on track, trying to get things going again, you know, having been somewhat stalled out, I was able to, you know, get this very clear advice as what to do. And it may not make a lot of sense to you, but this is just an example of the inner creativity, meditative creativity that we can get. And we may think, wow, this is really advanced, but actually it's very simple, it's very basic. The inner meditation master is not some esoterically complex master. They recognize the simplicity of it, but it seems very profound, but it's actually quite simple. And the advice was to view the thoughts that are arising from distraction, from arrogance. Just don't do anything. Don't try to do anything with the thoughts. Just see they're arising. And it was shown to me that they're arising like oil arises from a oil spill, like under the Gulf of Mexico, when that oil well blew out, and the oil was just, you know, constantly emerging from this blown out oil well at the bottom of the Gulf of Mexico. It's like that. These thoughts are bubbling up, as it were, like dark crude oil, constantly bubbling up. But it's the same thought. It's the same oil, right? You look at the oil spill. I looked on a webcam for a while. Actually, for a while, it gets kind of boring. Yeah, it's just oil, this oil bubbling up. And the thoughts, actually, at their root, are all like just this dark oil bubbling up. Okay, as if from a blown out well. Okay, so that was the first bit of advice. Simply don't engage or try to do anything with those thoughts at all. Now, preceding this, I had recognized that the only cure for insanity is to put your attention onto sanity. That's the only cure there is. You can't cure insanity by engaging with it. It's impossible. You have to simply put your attention onto sanity, and then that cures. That's it. That's the cure. It's the only cure there is. And yet this is what we have so much trouble with. So the meditation advice is just allow the thoughts of insanity, just let them arise. Don't try to do anything. And I said, wow, they're rising. Boom, 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 just nonstop like this. Okay. Like oil emerging from an oil well spill. And then, okay, so doing that, I say, okay, I'm doing that. And what's the next? Okay, then the next advice was, okay, kind of feel like you're reaching over with your hand to the origin of that oil spill, where it's actually coming out of the ground instead of the, once the oil gets into the ocean, it billows and it takes on all sorts of appearances and forms and spreads everywhere. It says, don't pay any attention to any of that. Don't struggle with any of that. Put your finger over by where the oil well is, coming out, where it's coming out, seems to be coming out of the ground. And then put your finger there and then press down. So I did that. And suddenly, poof, it all stopped. All the thoughts stopped. I said, wow, okay, I see. They all stop by doing that. Right. Okay, that's where my attention is on. And then the next bit of advice was, now, take your finger off and now look. Imagine that you so-called plugged it. Okay, you've plugged it somehow. Now look at this. It was like a concrete slab. Now look at this slab, this concrete slab. Now what do you see? Do you see any plug? What is this? Just look at it. So I started looking at it. And I said, hey, I don't see the plug. I don't see any plug at all. So the advice was just keep looking at it. Now this is the meditation. Just look at it. And so now I said, well, I can't see the plug. Maybe it's really tough to see. Maybe it's cut so finely. I can't hardly see it. So I sprinkled some dust on it. Sprinkled some dust, and I've been brooming that, brushing it around on the slab where I thought I had plugged it, looking for if I could see any, you know, real fine little cut. And I didn't see anything. Now I started then to hallucinate a little bit, thinking, well, maybe that, wait, I think I see it. I think I see maybe this. Not really hallucinating, but wishful thinking. I think I see maybe that, and then I brush some more. It's just, oh no, it isn't. So I'm just brushing this fine dust around this concrete slab, looking to see where is the plug? Where's the plug? So this is the meditation. And then eventually I dozed off because this sort of the shock factor sort of set me back a little bit. So this is the meditation. Okay, three parts to it. Just see all these thoughts arising at their root. It's just the same thought. It's the same thought, basically. It's the call to arrogance. It's the call to camouflaging arrogance. It's the call to insanity. It's a call to engage with insanity. It's basically, it's the same thought arising, but then as it moves in the currents of the ocean, it seems to, you know, things get very complex and complicated seemingly. But it's the same rising fast, over and over and over and over and over, repeating itself very fast. So don't do anything with it, with the thoughts, struggle, just notice. And then reach over and plug it with your finger. So no thoughts arising. And then take your finger off and look and see where the plug is, if and see if you can find the plug. Now, I didn't see any plug. And I started saying, well, that's weird. There has to be a plug. I plugged it, didn't I? And of course, now the whole purpose of the meditation is to recognize that there isn't a plug. The entire blown oil well was all hallucination. It was never there, never actually happening. But we need to practice this looking. So it's a meditation practice. I was looking to see, where is it? Is it here? Is it here? Is it here? And then gradually get used to recognizing that there isn't any plug. Gradually. That's why it's practice. You get nervous about it and start imagining that you're seeing a plug. Oh yeah, I can see where it was. Where, I think I see where it was plugged. Even though, then you say, wait a minute, honestly, I might not be so. This is how I was going. Say, that might not be true. Let me spread this fine dust and see. No, I don't think the plug is there. You know, just sort of going back and forth on this. Where is it? Maybe there isn't a plug. No, I it stopped, so I must have plugged it. You know? And then the deeper truth begins to sink in as you do this. So this is a meditation that was suggested to me, and I carried it out. So we do have this tremendous ally within us that I ask for suggestions, and it suggests, you know, try this. So this is what we need to do. We need to ask for help. What do you want me to try? And then just stay attentive. Stay attentive. It may be something very different than what you expect. I didn't expect this at all, But I just went with it. You just go with it. Once you see this, you say, okay, I'll go with this. It seems like maybe this feels like there's some potential here. Now, prior to this, I was doing a lot of work, and I realized I was working on the clarification that it's our attempts. I had this like this stone monolith or some big stone, and it was like foggy, and the gradually the fog was being burned off, revealing the stone. And I said, hey, the stone's been there all along. The fog was just obscuring it. So this is a pretty typical non-dual understanding, right? That Christ mind, Buddha mind, non-dual mind is natural face, natural mind. It is already there. It's just, we just need to reveal it. Okay, so I thought, okay, yeah. And then a clarification happened. And I saw that it's actually what's causing all this fog. And I actually realized it's our attempts to reveal it that's causing the fog in the first place. That everything stands naturally already revealed. And it's our attempt to reveal it that obscures it. And I said, oh wow, that is the obscuration. So the efforts to clarify are what ultimately is obscuring. However, clarifying this is important, you see. So clarification does have a role. It absolutely does have a role. But ultimately, it goes back to no effort at all. Ultimately, all the clarification that the inner guru is doing is bringing us back to no effort at all. You might say in that meditation practice I had, it was my belief that I needed to plug something that made me think that there was a rupture, and then these thoughts of self-delusional thoughts were repeating because I desired to plug something. So I plugged it, and then I looked and I said, wait a minute, there's no plug there at all. I didn't plug anything. It's our desire to reveal reality which obscures it from us. That is the fog. And so this was, a wow recognition. But we have to try and be pretty sober about this and just say, okay, yeah, it's a big deal, but I have to keep going here. But we take a little moment. We have to manage our success. So we take a little moment to say, yeah, that's quite stunning to recognize this and say, oh gosh, that's here I am trying to play hero. I'm trying to reveal reality. I'm trying to reveal it. And it's that effort itself that is obscuring it. So I'm experiencing the shock of this right now, actually. I wish I wasn't so much, but it is. It is shocking. So what can you do? It's our very effort to overcome trouble that is the trouble. It's our efforts to reveal reality is the obscuration of it. What arrogance to think that we need that reality has to be clarified or revealed. See, that's what started our troubles, our self-delusion. The obscuration is we thinking, hey God, we need to reveal what you are. Now, we got sidetracked. We don't reveal what God is so much as we, you might say, we complete God by our adventures and our experiencing. But we took it too far. We took it too far in so far as we think that reality needs to be revealed to itself, or we have to find an answer. This is trying to really change the direction of creation, trying to be prime creator. So it obscured reality to us. And then we said, you see, we need to reveal it. So if we don't see the mistake we made, we think that our mistake is justified. And then it's not a mistake, but a heroic effort. I'm getting all sorts of tingling in my face, severe tingling. So my nose is just... Again, we maintain all the basic disciplines. Imagine that you're a session musician. There's all these disciplines. You have your space there. You know what your role is, the levels, the miking, you know, everything. You have your basic discipline there. The whole thing runs smoothly. So here, we just sit quietly, hands to hands, very, very severely modest. We're not itching. We're not scratching anything. We're not eating, we're not distracting ourselves, we're trying to just keep us, you know, just still, pretty still, quiet, not doing any actions, we're not turning anything reactions into actions, just full stop in the wow, remaining seated like this. This is the basic meditative discipline, just like a session musician would be sitting on a stool with their guitar. They're not moving all over the studio. They pretty much sit on their seat or stool, and you know, that's what they do, and they don't get in each other's way. So we maintain our discipline here, meditative discipline. You maintain it. You're a professional. Take it seriously. You see, reality needs no clarification for it to be what it is. It's not that we don't need clarification of reality. It is that, you know, that it's crystal clear how reality functions. We just thought, it's to say that we're trying to clarify reality is actually a camouflage of our arrogance, saying actually we want to change it. And we say, no, we're not trying to change it, we're just trying to reveal it, we're just trying to clarify it. This is arrogance. It's not true. Okay, so we're tracing back the roots of arrogance and letting go of these camouflages that we've put up to defend it. It's absolute reality is totally crystal clear to reality, inherently so. Doesn't need any clarification. And any attempt at clarification is the obscuration, actually. Is the obscuration. However, we do need, because of our continuity fear, we do need to look at this. Sometimes when you have a splinter, you use a needle to remove the splinter. You use something sharp to remove something sharp. So we use clarity to trace clarity back to what's the origin of clarity? What's the origin of it? Where is it coming from? We use clarity to uncover all these camouflages, but then we recognize, that any attempt to clarify actually obscures reality in our mind. Which is why ultimately we're told, drop all efforts. Let go of all efforts. No effort is needed for reality to know itself, to know what it is. No effort is required. Reality does require our creativity, which is natural to us, and our flowing creativity and experiencing, that is required. But it's crystal clear to us that this is required, and this is our function as spirit. And it's not like we need that function to be clarified to us. We don't. It's our arrogance. This is the trickiness of it, is we're camouflaging our arrogance, believing that reality isn't perfect, so that we can then hold out the goal of being greater than reality by bringing ourselves to some so-called perfection. Which is why we bring ourselves in practice to just looking. Like in the meditation practice, I was told, just look at the slab, the concrete slab, just look at it and tell me where's the plug? Is there, is there a plug there? Is there a plug? So I just looking. And I was seeing. There isn't any plug. So this looking and seeing is letting go of the last bit of obscuration. It's going beyond words, as it were. Going beyond words. We've got the word so simple now. We can easily simply. So we're sort of getting out of our own way, as a way to put it. Getting out of our own way. We can easily just look and see, and then say, oh. And then inherently there arises in us this recognition. This reality doesn't even need to be recognized. There is no plug, so I don't need to recognize the plug. Reality doesn't need me to recognize a non-existent plug. I didn't plug a problem. There wasn't any problem. So I certainly don't need to recognize ultimately that there isn't any problem. Say, okay, I don't see any problem. Ultimately, we can even drop that recognition. But it may be that the last step is to go beyond words and just seeing that there isn't any problem. Okay. Now, Jesus calls this healed perception, where we're looking and we're seeing, like in this meditation, I was seeing this slab of concrete and I didn't see any plug, seams, no plugs, no seams. It was seamless. I said, well, how did that happen? I thought I plugged it. It's seamless. I said, no, it it's always been seamless. So we're noticing, it's always been seamless. There's never been a problem, but we're still seeing it. Now, Jesus tells us that is as far as we can go and still reliably maintain a body and functioning in this world. Okay, now, there may be some rare instances of avatars or something who can come into the world and actually be in a state of knowing. I think that is possible. I think Ananda Maima actually was an example of that, where is able to know, but in the knowing condition, actually her body was inert and was just like a lump of coal. It was just this frozen piece of ice, sort of. So really, she was not really able to keep the body functioning if she went into complete knowing, as the great bliss, as she called it. So I guess that's an example showing that what Jesus said is true. You can't really keep the body functioning and interacting and in a presence here, that people will see as a living presence. If you're in, if you allow simply knowing, you know, you will not be able to do it. Maybe she was just showing us this, that this is how it is. There's the bliss, and then there's beyond that. She says there's beyond the beyond. There's the great bliss, which is nothing can be said about it at all. And then the body would just go into this just complete, like it was totally dead, totally inert, totally lifeless. And then they'd have to, it was very difficult to get her out of that knowingness. Sometimes it took days to get her out of it by people chanting and praying and chanting and trying to create a holy atmosphere and asking and pleading, come, and slowly she would slowly emerge out of that and then return to what the normal blissful condition where the body was now talking and moving and functioning, and people say, "Oh, you're alive." And she say, "Actually, no, I've gone into a lesser condition of bliss, which is seeing that there's no problem anywhere, instead of just knowing, just isness, pure knowing, where you don't even, the idea of no problem doesn't even exist at all. See, but seeing is seeing, see, I'm seeing there isn't any problem. And this is called, Jesus says, healed perception. So, you see, these great teachers are on the same, they're on the same page of the book. They're on the same page. This is what I've noticed. So, our goal is to see that there's no problem. So that's what I was doing in this meditation. I was advised, just see, are you seeing any plug there? And I said, no, I don't see any plug at all. Now, I believe our fear is that we will then shift quickly into knowing. And if we did this, our body would quickly become inert, no question about it. And we would have no awareness of this world whatsoever, actually. The end of perception, there'd be no perception taking place, actually. No need for the body whatsoever. And even healed perception is not using the body's senses. It's just, so we're afraid to that we might go into that. So, now, I believe that our will can be in play here, where we have the compassion. Compassion is the spiritual will to not go into knowingness, but to keep your attention on healed perception, on seeing that there isn't any problem. And then this is how you can function. So you have to be like a bodhisattva. For instance, the idea of the bodhisattva is they refrain from going into the great bliss so that it can be of use to us. So they're, again, same page in Buddhism. It's the same page. We've just cross-referenced three great traditions, and it's all the same page. So in Buddhism, the bodhisattva ideal is those who stay in the condition of seeing that there's no problem. Now, you can go back and forth, actually. Just like Ananda Maima was an avatar who came from knowing into seeing that there's no problem. Came into this world, and they asked her, did you come into this world based on any karma whatsoever? And she said, no, I've never ever, my consciousness never ever has never been self-deluded, meaning they never had ever gone into self-delusion and had to work themselves out of it at all. That's what's called an avatar in that tradition, someone who comes from pure knowing, who's never strayed from it, into this world. It's very rare that that happens. And they go into, she had to acquaint herself with seeing that there's no problem. And this was actually quite a effort on her part to do this. She went through a vast amount of meditational exercises and things to get into, so she, you know, to seeing, healed perception. Because for her, what she was used to was just knowing. Just knowing. There's nothing else. Meaning, not, you know, this was spirit coming, as it were, from knowing, pure knowingness, reality, into seeing that there's no problem, and then relating to us, helping us get to this intermediate step, which we need to get to. So there is this will to do this. This is the bodhisattva ideal, and this is the savior ideal in Christianity, and the avatar ideal, or avatar ideal in Hinduism, and then in Buddhism, bodhisattva ideal. This is, you know, it's healed perception is what it is. We can take all the vagaries of these different terms and you know, push them aside, because it's really healed perception. We're seeing that there isn't any problem. That's what it really is. So we're trying to be very ecumenical here. I've always been this way, where I try to use terminology where you're no longer bothered by, you know, is there someone an arhant or a bodhisattva, or, you know, they've gone. We realize that those terminologies, but what it really is healed perception. We're seeing, oh, there isn't any problem. Not only are we seeing that there's no trace of it ever, of a problem ever being fixed. You see, I was told to look at this and see where's the plug. There's no trace of any plug. No trace of anything ever being plugged. And I said, I sort of like, wow. That's called healed perception. So the meditation that we're aiming towards is this constant state of looking and seeing. There's not even any trace of a fix anywhere. Just seeing that. And being willing to stay in that condition, heal perception, and not trying to go into knowing, because you won't be able to function here. And we have the word, of Jesus on this, and then we have the demonstration of this by Ananda Maimonides, proving what Jesus' word, showing you, indeed that is so. Indeed that is so. I was told to study the life of Ananda Maimonides so that I could verify what Jesus was telling me. The Holy Spirit says, look, this is the verification. What Jesus is saying is true. Here's an example. Study this example. So I did. I studied that example. And indeed, that's what happened. So we are not trying to get to knowing. Anyone who is trying to push in that direction is doing a disservice, because that frightens us, actually. Because we want to be, quote-unquote, a bodhisattva, a savior, an avatar. Well, not quite an avatar, because we certainly have gotten into being derailed in a side trip of self-delusion, arrogance. The imaginary pit of camouflaging arrogance. We certainly have been suffering from that. So but you know, a guru, you know, someone who is aware, is helping, saying, come to this intermediate step of healed perception. You know, you can make it. You can make it here. Don't worry about knowing. Jesus often says, "There's much beyond this that I can't even talk about, because you." There's no way you can understand whatsoever, because that's knowing. If we say, well, what's reality like? Well, Jesus says, I can't explain it to you. It's not possible. It's the knowingness, and it's totally beyond anything we can imagine. It's beyond any perceptuality we can imagine. So it's completely futile to focus on that. Don't focus on it. And Ananda Maimonides said, leave out the avatar-ness, the knowingness. Leave that out from your discussions. Did you say, leave me out of this? Meaning, leave that-ness of the knowingness. Don't make that your goal. And Mahayana Buddhism says, you know, just get to be a bodhisattva. Okay, that's your goal. They say, well, postpone, you know, the parinirvana, going into parinirvana, postpone that. Well, yeah, if you want to function here, you have to postpone that. And so the idea, you know, they tend to be very, Buddhism tends to have these sort of interesting formulas that for emphasis. And they say, I'm going to remain a bodhisattva until everyone is saved, you know. Actually, that's the function of, in Christianity, we'd say it's the function of the Holy Spirit. That's what the Holy Spirit does. And in Buddhism, there's probably some term like the function of what, Vajrasattva or something, that there is that which remains that until all are saved. But we don't literally have to remain bodhisattvas until everybody is saved. But that's how they, you know, emphasize it. And, you know, that's okay. There's a lot of religion is to keep our attention on the path, and so they use all sorts of ways of tricks and ways and emphasis, you know, these things to help us out. And if we don't understand, you know, what the path's really about, we get very confused and frustrated. Well, great, why they, you know, but. But if we're really into it, like if you're a musician, you understand other musicians. If you're really into this, this doesn't bother you. These various different religions don't bother me. I understand that in various circumstances, situations, attention, distractions, whatever, in the culture, in the whole, wherever, these various situations, various ways and means, skillful ways and means, were utilized to build momentum, etc., etc., and just different terms and words and, you know, strategies and stuff is utilized. And just like, let it be water off your back, water off a duck's back. Just turn to your inner guru and say, what do you suggest for me right now, right here, right now? That's the real path. The real path is, what is your inner guru suggesting to you right now? So I don't, you know, don't get caught up or worried about, you know, well, these techniques were used, you know, 2,000s of years, they've been used for thousands of years. And I said, well, that's great, you know. But what is my inner guru, what is suggesting to me right now? That's what's important. I don't really care too much about this tradition or that tradition, or you need to stay in this tradition or stay in there. These are the ways we've used for so long, and you need to do this. And I say, no, you know, the inner guru will tell me what's most effective for me. Beyond any tradition, I'll be more effective, actually. Now, it may very well be that what they say correlates with some skillful means that has been used for a long time. Sure, why not? That doesn't mean that I went to the tradition first. No, I went to the inner guru first. Which, how did the tradition get started in the first place? By people going to their inner guru, by us going to our inner guru and getting this advice and then sharing with others, and others say, hey, I think I'll try that also. And gradually a tradition arises, like a lot of people are using this. But ultimately, we need to recognize that we are inherently free of all tradition. Okay, we're not bound by any tradition, but we're also not bound to not use skillful means that have been used in the past. We're not circumscribed from doing that at all. We're free to either, you know, do something new or do something that's been used before. We're perfectly free to do that. Like a musician will do some riff that maybe it's been done before, or they may throw something in that people haven't heard before. Also, they're free to use a whole grab bag of creativity. So the inner guru suggests to us, and people say, oh yeah, that's very similar to Dzogchen. And I say, well, that doesn't matter one way or the other, really. I'm not labeling it Dzogchen or this or that. A better way is skillful means. You know, this is what the in the East they say the Dharma means, skillful means, really. You're supposed to live the life of live the Dharma. That's your Dharma is your responsibility. In Judeo-Christianity, we say spiritual practice is your responsibility. It really means skillful means. So it's your responsibility to engage in skillful means that bring you to enlightenment. So ultimately, the responsibility rests upon each one of us. And we have to turn to the inner guru and say, what do you want me to practice now? And ultimately, of course, we get to recognizing no practice. Different terminology, no self. You know, there's like books written, like experience of no self or something. Well, that's just a terminology being used. Don't worry about those terminologies, self or no self and all this stuff. It's that basically it means no effort. The self, when the people talk about the self, they're really referring to the I. It means that which is making effort. And so ultimately dropping the I means you're simply dropping effort to clarify reality, to reveal reality. You drop the effort, and by dropping the effort, reality is self-revealed. Longchenpa calls it, or at least Keith Dalman's translation would be self-sprung awareness. You know, it's not requiring anything to reveal what it is. Spontaneity, self-sprung awareness, spontaneous self-sprung awareness is simply referring to there isn't any need for any effort to reveal reality as it is. It's self-revealed. It stands clear as it is. It's always already clear. It's always already entirely revealed. But what we do is we say, see, oh, I don't see any problem with this. I don't see any, there's no trace of anything being fixed. This is healed perception. I clearly see that there isn't any effort to fix made that to enable this to be clear, everything to be revealed as it is, the isness. I'm seeing that there isn't any problem with the isness, like that. So I was always baffled by the terminology. I wanted to see the pragmaticness of it, underlying all these traditions. That's why I didn't follow any tradition, actually. I was a maverick. Because ultimately, you need to get beyond arguments, you know, really. That's very distracting. And the more ecumenical our spirit is, the more it helps others. Because we're not trying to promote one tradition over another. We're not promoting tradition. We're promoting enlightenment. We're not promoting empowerment. We're promoting meditation that leads to enlightenment, to salvation, to recognizing healed perception. We're promoting healed perception. And that includes not clinging to any, ultimately not clinging to any words at all. And so, for instance, in Jesus and the Course in Miracles, he says, ultimately, when you go beyond and don't need any of the words here at all, then you're saved. Yeah. That's the goal. The goal of Course in Miracles is to make itself completely unnecessary. Same thing with Longchenpa and Dzogchen. You know, ultimately, the goal of Dzogchen is really no Dzogchen, no teaching. It transcend all of this clarification too. Absolutely, and not transcend it, let it go, or recognize it was never needed. That it's vanished without a trace. The I, which is supposed the I, the self, which is our efforts, vanished without a trace. The effort maker vanished without a trace. The clarifier vanished without a trace. There's no clarifier anymore. And so what you're seeing is, hey, there's no clarifier anywhere, and there's no evidence that they ever did anything. I'm not seeing any evidence that any clarification was ever made to reveal what I'm, you know, seeing. All stands inherently revealed without any trace of any effort ever being made to reveal it. And this is what we would call, you know, different terms: natural mind, enlightened mind, saved mind, liberated mind, non-dual mind. You know, it's just, but pragmatically, we're recognizing, oh, I don't see any trace of any effort anywhere. Wow. Wow. Jesus always told me, don't get stuck in A Course in Miracles tradition. Don't get stuck in that tradition. He says, the whole point of A Course in Miracles is to free us from getting stuck in any tradition. And so he's very adamant about that. He says, come on, don't go. You need to go fast, so you feel like you can get free of it. Don't get stuck in the words. Don't get stuck in the concepts. Don't even get stuck in the clarifications. Keep going. Simpler and simpler and simpler. Reduce. So the amount of effort you're making to clarify becomes less and less and less. And this is why in like videos I can boil it down to a point where it's just a simple looking. It's either this or this, and that's it. Either there's an abyss or there isn't. Either reality was an abyss or it's never been an abyss. One of the two. That's it. And just simply look. That's the end of it. It's the end. No more call for clarification once you get to just seeing it. That's simple. So this is the goal on the path, is reduce, simplify. Put yourself on a severe spiritual diet. You see, the problem is with the ascetics who are mortifying the flesh. They're trying to put their body on a severe diet instead of their spiritual practice, their spiritual, put your spiritual path on a severe diet. Means reduce, simplify. So just a glance is all you need. And then that glance ultimately turns into just a continual look, seeing. Put yourself on a spiritual diet. Now, that doesn't mean you don't eat anything. That'd be an extremism too. That would mean trance state. Okay, so Buddha is very wise, saying that no trance, not trying for trance states, and you're not trying for mortifying the flesh, putting the flesh on a diet. Neither one of those are the answer. Trance state is a type of fixation, and we don't need to describe it too much, because I think intuitively you realize that you come out of the trance state, you know, it's still an effort to clarify, isn't it? It's still making effort. That's not, trance state is not free of any effort. It's not the natural, freely resting condition where you're seeing that no fix has ever been applied to reality at all. No clarification has ever been applied to it. There's been not the slightest need for it. In other words, awareness is still pure awareness. Pure awareness is always pure awareness. There's only pure awareness. There's never been any fix of awareness at all. And then this reveals our arrogance as the problem. The only problem there is our arrogance. Jesus tells us the only problem we have is our desire to have a problem. That's it. There isn't anything else. The only trouble we can ever have is our own desire to try to change what we are. But other than that, there is impossible for any trouble. So seeing that, you know, awareness has always been pure awareness, that reveals that then the only our arrogance has ever been in play. That's it. And that's a play without any effects. So we've just been basically kind of experiencing like inertness, meaninglessness, all this while. And since we can't tolerate that, and we don't want to drop this arrogance, we work on camouflaging it as if that were meaningful. But the meaning is always pushed into the future. Say, as soon as I fix it, then I'll get the meaning. You see, so we're in this situation where we're chasing after something. We think we're chasing after meaning. We almost got it. It was always in the future. It's always being pushed in the future. Because we're not fixing anything, actually. And being unwilling to recognize our arrogance, if we see the now as it is, we'd recognize, oh, it's only arrogance that's been in play. That's it. And it has no effects. Trying to change reality has no effects. It's not just sheer arrogance. Because we wouldn't see any fix at all in the now. We'd say, it's perfect without any trace of anything being done or altered or fixed at all. We haven't done anything to make it this way. And then that would reveal our arrogance. So instead of revealing our arrogance and letting it go, we push the success into the future, saying, as soon as I fix it, then I'll be happy. But we're not seeing the fix right now. So, well, it's in the future. It's in the future. What's that? A little bug. Okay, a little bug. It's not a mosquito. I don't want to. The bug is just being very silent. It's still just sitting there, very silent. Still, this is what we do. When we able to look at it this way, we can see what the bug is, what the bug really is. So the bug is just sitting there right in front of me, absolutely still. It's not moving at all. And okay, now it's gone. I closed my eyes and now it's gone. So I should have kept my eyes open. So when we look at reality, look at the now, and see that we don't see any trace of any fix anywhere, that's keeping our eyes open, as it were. And then when we sort of fade off from that, like we close our eyes and we lose the clarity, lose the recognition. I mean, there's a difference between clarity and clarifying, attempts to clarify. What we need to do is rest in clarity, okay, instead of, you know, drop all the efforts to clarify and just simply rest in the clarity that no efforts to clarify are needed. No efforts to fix anything are needed. Reality is not confusing in the slightest bit. So this is like session work. It's spiritual session work is what it really is. Now, if you're a session player, you know, you get this. Like, if you're a musician, you're a session player, you understand what the other musicians are about and their creative process and what you're there for, and you're bouncing all these ideas. What about this groove? What about this riff? Yeah, maybe you could go like this. Maybe this. And say, well, is this? And you're bouncing all this stuff off of one another like that. And You get it. You understand what's going on. And you don't need to break it down over-explain to anyone. That's the session players have a very, their creativity is very quick, and they know how to stay out of their own way and how to stay out of each other's way too. Otherwise, how could they, you know, keep cutting these tremendous backing tracks, these rhythm tracks? Very intuitive. Very intuitive. I saw that one of them, I think, has played on over 100 top 10 hits. Can't read a word of music. Never read a chart, never read a note, nothing. All feel, all intuitive, all just, you know, creative. And it's a fabulous player. Wow. Yeah, so we don't need to get all technical here about exactly, you know, what do you mean exactly, you know, in Tibetan Buddhism, what is it, does it mean, is it Togol or some other term, or is it, how does it, no, that's getting in your own way, that's getting in the way of the other musicians, so to speak, that's getting in the way of the song, it's getting in the way of the song, don't get in the way of the song. All right, there's a song that we need to hear, actually. This is metaphorically meaning the seeing, that there's no trace of any fixing has ever taken place. No trace of any clarification is present at all. Resting in that clarity, the clarity of no clarification. And that's the song we need to hear. Sneeze is building up. That's the song we need to hear. Just saw that. See how that sneeze didn't get in my way? It tried to rise up. I was able to dissipate it. Instead of a kaboom, you know, that just sort of shocks the room. No, you don't do that in a session. You don't sneeze. You don't create. You don't get in your own way. You don't get in the way of the song. So these session players were there to reveal, so to speak, the song. To get out of the way of the song. They were there to get out of the way of the song. And I may have to... Yeah, that's what I thought. 1 minute.
Hello?
So there are occasional situations where you do need to recognize, okay, just a slight break there. That does happen. That was necessary. So the session players, their song is there. They're just trying to get out of the way of it, so to speak. And they're very good at getting out of the way and letting the song emerge. And so that's what we do too. This is what the path is all about. You cannot be on the spiritual path meditating unless you get this, you know, of get out of your own way. Keep getting out of the way of the song. Keep getting out of the way of the song. And the session players are tell stories of musicians want to come in. Hey, I want to play on song. I'm a player, you know. And they say, no. You know, you can't do that. And only some become session players because they get out of the way of the song. And a lot of musicians, they want to be the song. You know, they want to show how good they can play. They want to, you know, they're on an ego trip, in other words. And that doesn't work as a session player. It doesn't work at all. One thing I notice about these session players is like there's very little ego in them at all, you know, just amazing. They're there, they're open to the song, all of them, and they're not trying to big time each other at all. And they'll you know, glom on to some another's riff here. They'll say, oh, it's a nice riff, I'll go with that. And they'll share their creativity. So, you know, it's quite something. So in spiritual session playing here, we're revealing the song of freedom, really. And so we continually work to get out of the way of that song. And so there's necessary disciplines for that. And you cannot just allow anybody to barge in, and it will just completely disrupt the session. Absolutely it will. You have to maintain the disciplines. Now, you might have some, like in the sessions, there's a producer, and like you might use an example of Jesus as being a producer and the apostles being session players, you know, the house band. They knew how to get out of the way of the song of salvation. Same with Buddha, the song of the Buddha. There were those who came who were able to, you know, get out of the way of the song of the Bodhisattva song. And so they're able to then help, you know, spread it. And say, these are the disciplines you need. These are the disciplines you need. Continually, the get out of the way, keep working your discipline is to get out of the way, so you go from clarification to simple clarity. Which means your clarifications become simpler and simpler and simpler, closer and closer and closer to simple, dropping all effort to clarify, and simply abide in the clarity of seeing there isn't any fix at all. But now, if this shocks us, we'll go back into clarification, right? Words, concepts. Effort. The ego and the world is going towards self-empowerment. The Holy Spirit is bringing us to getting out of the way of what's inherently present. No effort. No I, no self. No collection of efforts, which we call an I or a self. So somebody would say, I'm in the experience, the mystical experience of no self. They put in the Christian tradition, they can do terminology. Okay, and someone else from another tradition will say their terminology. Same. They're not making any efforts at all to fix anything in the present moment. The present moment stands inherently revealed as it is, with no trace of any effort ever being made for it to be what it is. No trace at all. And we just experience this effortless tracelessness. And we're seeing this. That's, you know, so. if I didn't, if I wasn't a spiritual session player, I would have wanted to be a session player, musician session player, actually. I actually trained to do that, but Holy Spirit had other plans for me. I said, no, you can do better than this. You have a higher calling. I was certainly creative enough to do it, but I was I got in my own way because I wanted to do this spiritual session work. So I was not, I just got in my way too much. But in terms of creativity, absolutely, I could have done it. Now, a lot of people like music because they feel it reveals, helps reveal, because good music tends to get out of its own way. The best music gets out of its own way. And this is the music that I'm attracted to. And it's awesome. Oftentimes very simple music. I mean, just, but you can just feel the spaciousness. It's the lack of ego in there. It's getting out of its own way. It's just, you know, so, but that in no way is that, that's just sort of fooling around, you know. I mean, it's not the path of meditation. The path of meditation is what actually works. Music just kind of gives us a faint echo, an empty echo of the path, really. And we have a sort of this, it gives us a longing, sort of a vague longing, like, yeah, getting out of my own, wouldn't it be great if we could get out of our own way? Kind of that sort of feeling. Wouldn't it be great if we get out of our own way? But it doesn't really go any further than that, actually. It's kind of like a drug or a narcotic, actually, music. Because it sort of hints at a faint, empty echo of getting out of our own way. Because of all these notes that could be sung, you know, we're leaving all the stuff out. And I said, oh, isn't that great to leave all that out? Yeah. All this effort. You know, out of all the effort that could be made, only this little effort is being made in this song, you know. And you just say, wow, oh, that's nice. And I like the songs that sort of amble without rushing. You see, out of all the speed that could happen, only this gentle ambling is there. And it's just all the notes, only these few notes, only this few things, you know, and just, hey, that's great. But that's as far as it goes, you know. That's the thing. I always say that music is the lazy person's narcotic. Too lazy for the spiritual path. And even if I was had been a session player, it's still lazy compared to the spiritual path. It's very lazy. I don't care how many hit records could have played on hundreds of hit records, like a Hal Blaine or something, but that's still tremendous spiritual laziness. Not really applying yourself the way you really can, the way we really truly can. You're just basically taking it easy and being lazy. So, you know, I had to face musicians are all really very lazy. That's the lazy person's path. Which was, you know, certainly shocking, but true. I mean, I had to accept it, and I had to look at my arrogance, because in past life I was a virtuoso musician, and I had to realize that I was just lazy, actually. And, that's a tough one to swallow, because I thought I was, you know, being doing heroic efforts, which seemed to be I was, because I was using a lot of stimulants to keep my efforts, you know, being very intense and work so hard and constantly. And so many people thought, wow, this is an ideal of someone who makes maximum effort in this world. And I had to admit and see and recognize that, and no, it was just someone who was using very clever contrivance to appear to be maxing out, when in fact I was just being cleverly lazy. I was avoiding my responsibility in a very, very cleverly contrived way that everybody was applauding. I got so much applause, but of course they're applauding because that's what they wanted. They wanted to avoid their responsibility too. They wanted to keep their arrogance too. They didn't want the tough work to reveal arrogance as it is, as the only, you know, the only problem there can be is us being arrogant. So, of course, people will applaud clever contrivances. You'll be famous and get all sorts of applause. But you pay the piper. You can't. And then came back another life. I said, hey, I don't want to come back here. And, well, you wasted your life. You didn't really apply yourself. And so you're not free. And so I had to come back here, which I wasn't happy about at all. And then had to really, really get to work. You know, stop the laziness. Cut out the laziness. And I, you know, almost I got pulled back into music. I kept saying, no, I can go back and do this. No. But it never worked out. It never worked out. Holy Spirit blocked it. And ultimately my own determination blocked it. Because I said, no, that doesn't work. But it's easy to fall back into old habits. I hear songs and I say, I could do better than that. You know, I say, look at these people, fame and fortune and all, look, high life and everything. I said, I could do better songs than that. It's not about easily. Yeah, but I couldn't get out of my own way, so I was unable to do it. Because I was determined to be liberated in this life. So I said, my spirit wasn't truly into it, you know. I said, no, I've got to do better. And so I never really could settle on songs. I kept saying, no, I can do better. It's not good enough. And I just said, forget it, you know. This. I got to make the perfect song that completely stays out of its own way. But it's never it. It's never it. It's still in its own. It's still in the way. Music doesn't get us out of our own way. It's sort of a faint echo, empty echo. So, you know, people say, yeah, you can do both. You should be able to do both. That's the ego, you know. No. It's like if you're a session player, you can't be goofing off in there and be a good session player at the same time. Even in their so-called goofing off, they're all business. They're serious. And they realize they have a job to do, and they've got to make a hit here. Or, you know, that's their job. So they're very focused. They, you know, you keep things a little bit light as it go along, but still, no, they can tell that they're always looking for, you know, the clarity, how to get out of there, how to get out of the way of the song. Method to their madness, in other words. We have to be the same way here. Method to our madness, so to speak. You know, as far as no self and no I, you know, you hear these various traditions talking about that. Okay, that's the effort, the efforting. And we drop that, there's no efforting. Now, if we don't see any fix anywhere, we might have a tendency to say, call the I back, the self back. Say, hey, you haven't fixed it yet. I don't see any, you haven't done anything. What have you been doing here? Come on. I need to fix this. I need to show evidence that all of this is justified. And then we the self comes back like this, the I comes back, because we call it back. Whereas if we're wise, we get the wisdom, we say, no, I just have to get used to seeing that there is no fix, that this has all just been sheer arrogance, nothing more. Nothing more than that. And that this is our own forgiveness. We're forgiving ourselves. By healed perception is really self-forgiving us, ourselves. Self-forgiveness. Why are we just saying, oh no, it was just sheer arrogance and nothing else. There's nothing ever other than sheer arrogance at play. The entire detour into fear was nothing but sheer arrogance at play. Nothing other than that. Nothing other than that. And this is not like some sad, terrible, you know, angry, like, I'm so angry. No, this is liberation. We're saying, oh, this is wonderful. I'm even able to forgive, you know, I'm able to forgive sheer arrogance. Just the incredible audacity to even try that, you know. We respect ourselves to just say, wow, all of this has been nothing but the play of sheer arrogance. Nothing other than that. The entirety of it. And then we also, by seeing that, we're honoring our creativity. Say, my gosh, how creative we've been to camouflage this all along. So it's not like we're going to get despondent or depressed. We're going to be very impressed by what we've done to engage ourselves in this farce that's been nothing but sheer arrogance the entire time. And that's like a wow, that's very impressive. So if we don't get depressed, we get impressed. Okay, so don't worry. Don't worry. We'll be very impressed. Like, my gosh, how could we've disguised this the whole time this was here and we were able to overlook it the whole time. That is really amazing creativity on our parts. We've been engaged in this collective dance of camouflage. It's super creative. So we don't get mad at other people either. We forgive them and we're so impressed. You say, wow, this is an awesomely impressive display of creativity to do all this. And yet now we're ready to move on to even creativity as it was meant to be experienced. It was not meant to be used to hide reality from us. And yet we're free to use it that way, but it's really not something that we want to continue on with indefinitely. So again, seeing that the no fix at all, nothing's been done to reveal reality at all, then we realize it's all been just sheer arrogance. We're automatically aware of that. And then we can just rest in that wow and say, wow, how creative we've been. Jesus says we don't get angry, we just have a laugh. It's a good laugh and then that's it. We don't get angry at ourselves. Because we're willing to move on. And to do so, we have to recognize our creativity. Well, what has our creativity been engaged with? We have to know that, you see? This is, and we realize it's been engaged with camouflaging sheer arrogance. That's what it's been engaged with. And then we feel, oh, okay, that has been my creativity. And we feel, okay, I still have all my creativity intact. I didn't lose it or anything. I don't need to do anything to be creative. I'm still creative. You know, I've always been creative. It's just I was using it to camouflage arrogance, sheer arrogance. And we regain our confidence in ourselves. Our confidence is restored. See, we're using our creativity now thinking we need to fix something. And unless we fix it, we won't really have our creativity. We're not really creative until we come up with a fix. That's not true. We've been perfectly creative all along. We've never lost it. There's no way to lose our creativity. There isn't any fix. It needs to be made at all. And that doesn't mean that we're not creative. We've just been creatively camouflaging this fact. So when we tip over into this perspective, then we're able then to abide in seeing this and seeing it's all been camouflaging sheer arrogance, nothing more than that. I was never engaged in a fix at all. It was only, the fix was to keep seeing that there is no fix necessary. But it's a perpetual, the problem is it's perpetual. We have to keep generating this camouflage. And so we always feel that somehow we're driven by fear. You know, we have creativity is driven by fear. I gotta keep, you know, obscuring the fact that the arrogance, you know, obscuring it. So the fix has to be continually worked on. But the creativity has always been there, actually, to overlook that there isn't any problem with reality. To overlook that, it takes a massive amount of creativity. Continually. See, there's no point where it's fixed, right? There's no point when you say, okay, now we finally fixed it and we don't have to keep obscuring reality because reality is now gone. You know, we never reached that point. Never. So it's a perpetual dead end. I had a dream last night, a visualization, sort of, that I was in a driveway, looking down this long driveway, and there's these fences all along, and at the end of the driveway there's this big fence too. It was nothing but fences, and I said, oh, it's just a dead end. And I was thinking, like, well, let me just drive down there for the fun of it, and just to see what happens if I get there. Maybe I can jump over the fence or something. And I said, wait, no. Look, it's a dead end. Just accept it's a dead end. And I paused and I stopped. And then I said, yeah, that is true. It's just a dead end. Now we can use all sorts of creativity to imagine how we could get over that fence and stuff, but it's really it's just a dead end, is all it is. That's all it is. And then I started to back out of the driveway. I said, well, wait, let me just then back out of this driveway and then go on driving, you know. Imagine if you're used to driving anywhere and you pull into a driveway, it's just a dead end. This is like what we've done. And you can use your creativity to think about how to get out of this dead end, but ultimately getting out of the dead end means backing out of it and driving our freedom to drive wherever we want to drive again, instead of being stuck in a dead end driveway. So I caught myself, I stopped, and I said, oh, no, that's enough. I'm not going down that driveway anymore. Forget it. Don't struggle with insanity. Just get your attention onto sanity. Insanity is nothing more than camouflaging our arrogance to believe that we change reality. And dropping that effort of camouflaging, we see, oh, no, the arrogance hasn't had any effects at all, because I didn't fix anything. I see reality as it is, and I don't see any fix. I didn't do anything to make it this way. I didn't fix anything. Therefore, arrogance doesn't have any effects. It's non-causative. It's non-causative. And ultimately, when we fully accept this, and we're used to this, completely used to it, then we can even drop this seeing. Because realizing arrogance is non-causative, we no longer need to engage in it at all. We drop it completely, and then we know, and that's beyond anything we can even imagine. So we won't make any efforts towards knowing. Well, our efforts are towards seeing. Okay, we're doing well here. And again, those session players play 15 hours a day, cut four sides a day. So if we're spiritual session players, let us not shirk from, you know, a couple hours here, a couple hours there, a couple hours here, like that. That's no big deal at all. We knock out 2.5 hours easily here. Well, we want to get a hit here. Okay, we're working on a spiritual hit. In other words, getting out of the way of the song of salvation even more. That's a spiritual song, spiritual hit. So, you know, when I do this taping, I'm intent on making a hit record, as it were. A hit spiritual record. A hit spiritual record. Which, where there's a meaning, there's a lot of getting out of the wayness, getting out of our own wayness here. And that, you know, that takes a lot of focus and seriousness and intent here. determination. I tried to get in back into music, and I started composing and recording and getting used to that, and the idea was I'd be able to play on eventually I'd be able to be able to play, you know, on a lot of hit songs by simply understanding the whole process and getting the confidence of doing it. But again, Holy Spirit had other ideas. You know, I strayed from the spiritual path, thinking that that it might be easier to, or I could contribute more musically to it. Boy, was I wrong about that. And of course, that's when I asked for help on that. What happened? The goddess rushed in, who's able to fixate us on this world, making us think that the world's wonderful. And I yesterday I realized some very clever tactics that the goddess uses to make this world seem attractive, is it actually puts you in a situation that's extremely unattractive. And then, by comparison, all the other situations in the world seem so attractive. And you think, oh my gosh, if only I weren't in this bad situation, there's a whole world full of attractiveness out there. For example, like put yourself like with a real quote-unquote unattractive person, very unattractive, terrible. Terribly unattractive. And by comparison, everybody else, all their bodies look attractive. And you say, well, if I weren't with them, look at how attractive everybody looks to me now. You know, it's like that. This is the goddess at work. This is the goddess. It's very tricky. She'll put you in a garbage dump. And so you say, my God, this is horrible. And you look at it and say, oh, everywhere else looks so attractive. If I could live in that house or have this job or that job. And so the world then becomes very attractive to you simply because your life is so wretched. So this is what the goddess did, made my life very wretched in so many ways, terrible ways. And then I'd look at the world and say, oh my gosh, the world, if only I see it's so attractive to me because my own condition is so terrible. Kind of a nasty trick though, isn't it? But the goddess knows her business, that is for sure. So if you want to try and make the world seem attractive to you again, the world of death, the goddess knows her business and will most definitely make it seem that way for you. Will make bodies seem attractive to you again by her tricks. She's a real hooker, the goddess, that is for sure. Whereas if you had things really nice, you might say, ah, I have all this nice stuff, everything's great, and this, the world's still unattractive to me. It's just, you know, what's the use? And you're able to look down and say, I have the best job, and I look at all these other jobs, and, you know, they're not attractive at all. Like, I know my job is much better than that, and still my job, I don't really not attracted to it, so maybe I need to transcend the world. No, instead of the goddess gives you, like, the worst possible job, and so then you look up and say, oh, if I had that job, I'd be happy. I know if I had that job, I'd be happy. Oh, I see thousands and millions of jobs. If I only had those, I could be so happy. And so then you think, well, the world would be a wonderful place easily if I could just get out of my problems I have, and so that you reinvest in the world that way. This is how she, this is one of the, I realized I saw through her tricks now. Very tricky. But, of course, I asked for it because I said, I didn't have the deep enough spiritual understanding, or I thought the path was too difficult. I felt that the resistance was too strong in the world. The devaluing of it was so strong. I said, even if I do this and be enlightened, nobody's going to pay attention, really. And so that was very tough for me because I was used to being so, in the previous life and lives, I was in the public eye so much. And was acclaimed for so much success, I said, look, if I'm enlightened, then I'm not going to get any acclaim at all in this world, you know, none. So I said, maybe I put some music to it and make some hit songs, then there could be some acclaim and people would be more attracted to it also. You know, well, what do you attract? Lazy people is what you attract with music. Laziness. That's for starters, actually. And even then, you need a powerful incentive to pull them out of their laziness. So I had to overcome all of that. I always tell Jesus, oh, well, you know, what good's enlightenment? Nobody's going to pay attention anyway. Yeah, you know, what good is it? And nobody will value it. They were taught, were trained to devalue reality here. And in this present culture, the training to devalue reality is extremes. Maybe the most extreme it's ever been. Anywhere, almost. You almost put it like that. It's so strong. So I said, hey, Jesus, nobody's going to pay attention anyway. And so that really, I felt so devalued, you know. So then I turned to the goddess for help, and she said, oh, sure, I'm a co-redeemer with Jesus. The two of us, we work together, which is nonsense. You know, that's her first lie right out of the bat. She tells the whopper of a lie. No, her business is to get us attracted to this camouflage effort, the world. That's her job. She does a very good job of it. But that has absolutely nothing to do with salvation. She's not co-redeemer with Jesus at all. She's working the opposite direction. But what is she going to say? I asked for her help. So in order to help me, she had to lie and say that she's simpatico with Jesus, because that's what I was paying too attention with before. So she can't come in and say, hey, you know, no, I'm the opposite of Jesus. I'm taking the opposite direction. You're going to forget everything that Jesus taught you. If she said that, you would say, no, I don't want that. So of course she has to come in and lie, and lie and deceive. To pull you away from truth, the path of truth, because that's what you're asking for. And again, it's our own creativity being used to deceive us, actually. Deceive ourselves, self-deception. Doesn't make it any less palatable, any more palatable, actually. Doesn't make it any more palatable. And then gradually I had to recognize that, you know, the music thing is not it. It's very brutal, very brutal. And that you may have to go, you know, with no acclaim at all. Like a session musician, they don't get any acclaim. Only those who are, you know, very sharp realize that. And they are complaining a little bit now that they didn't get any royalties from any of the hit songs. Many of them, they had way more to do with the song producing it than the artist. The artist just came in with some lyrics and said, this might be... or, you know, a few chords or whatever, not even much at all. And then they actually came up with the whole song, and then the artist just sang it. And the artist, producer, and even the engineers get the royalties, and the record company, the label, they get the money. And the session musicians get nothing out of that. And they're saying, hey, that's not fair. Plus, nobody even knew that they played on it. I mean, And one of them said that. They said, you know, most of the public, almost all the public, with, you know, few exceptions, have no idea that we even played on the records, that we even exist. And that's true. I didn't even know that for a long time. I was vaguely aware of a little bit of it, enough to, you know, but more so than most, but still, the extent of it, I was unaware of the extent of it, really unaware of it. And especially who the session musicians are. They were so talented, they could play any style at all, like rhythm and blues. They were playing rhythm and blues, and the stars would, they'd tell a story of this one star coming in to record with them. They looked in the recording studio and said, who are you? The star thought that they were just roadies setting up the instruments, and then they came back later and ready to record, and they said, same players were there, and they said, what are you guys doing here? Where's the band? And they said, well, we are the band. And I says, "You guys aren't. What are you talking about? You're not the band. I've listened to all the records that this studio has reproduced, and you can't be the players. You know, this stuff is a soulful, you know, soulful recordings here. You guys are just a bunch of old lumpy white guys. You know, you can't possibly be the band. They were going to leave. You know, they're not going to record with you." So the fact is that a lot of this music we've been hearing of all different genres have been produced, by, have been played and made by people that we don't have the image that we associate with the music at all. Not even remotely. I mean, the soul music, this rhythm and blues soul music, the rhythm tracks were done by these pasty white, geeky white men. Yeah, I look at them and say, you got to be kidding me. You couldn't possibly have made this music. Guess they did. And they kept them out. Of course, they didn't publicize this because they're selling an image. You know, they're selling an image. That the star is projecting this image, and you can't say, "Oh yeah, these are the people that actually, you know, made the song." The star came in for, like, you know, a couple takes and did the vocals, and then they're out of there. That's all they did. People would not buy that at all. Now Motown had black musicians on their session band, but the other ones, no. So a lot of the whole culture that we were sold in the 60s, 70s, and 80s was very fraudulent in a lot of ways, actually. Very much so. The idea that, for instance, we were told that white men have no soul. Yeah, well, all the soul records you heard, most of them, it was white men that were doing all the playing on that, actually. And so we grew up feeling very inferior. I remember, you know, thinking that, you know, I'm somehow inherently handicapped as a white male. We're handicapped. We don't have rhythm. We don't have soul. We don't have taste. We, you know, but I always thought, I said, there's something wrong with that narrative we're being told. Yeah, something wrong with that. I don't quite buy into that. Never bought into it. I said, I got all that stuff. You know, what do you mean? But we were heavily, heavily marketed. The corporations has marketed America on a bunch of lies, actually. So many lies. For their own reasons, actually. And these lies have now turned into, these myths and lies have now turned into our modern culture and the belief system we have. Belief system we have. I mean, I didn't even know this until just last night. I actually studied these recording studios and the songs and the players on it, and I just could hardly believe it. I mean, for instance, example, you're talking like Otis Redding, take Otis Redding or something. You know, these. I mean, these are the guys that played on these songs. You know, I just Wilson Pickett. You know, all these rhythm and blues stars and stuff. Okay, not all of them, but a lot of them. These hit songs, these are the guys that played the music on these songs, that came up with these licks, that did it. I just could hardly believe it, really. I mean, and they showed this one guy who's the guitar player, and I just said, you never believe in a million years that he was the one who did all these guitar playing on all these songs. No way. He's just like some... Looks like some hick. You think he's some hick driving an old pickup truck, you know? I mean, you just can't believe it. But then they play a song that he played on. I listened to it. And I said, "Oh my God, guy's a genius! Guy's an absolute genius!" But you'd never know. So they kind of told this big lie. The lie that's been getting told in pop culture and in this new world order, moving towards this goal that they had, it's built all on lies and deception, so much so, and urban myths and pop myths, so much false scholasticism, so many false studies, you know, they hire academics to do studies. I mean, a lot of universities are just myth making factories where they do studies. To come up with a conclusion that they've already, a predetermined conclusion that they've already that the New World Order has already decided this is the conclusion we want you to come up with. And so there's all these studies, and then you have authors who write books about these studies and present it as fact because they're coming from academia and stuff. And this is the whole 60s, 70s, 80s, all the way through to now, this whole cosmic corporate takeover of this planet is based on all these lies and deceptions. Taken as fact. And I tend to be able to catch all this. I said, whoa, wait a minute. This study, you know, who's doing this study? There's so much fraud in academia now. So much fraud that basically they're just hired guns. So are scientists, hired guns. The whole thing is utterly corrupt. So the entire body of what we think are facts, you know, is so super corrupt in this world now. It's all image. It's all leverage. It's just leverage and image. Whatever power you can get over people's beliefs and minds is just being used. That's all. It's leverage. It doesn't matter if they're lies. These people are so intent on self-empowerment, of being empowered, empowering the self of success, of camouflaging their arrogance is what it really is. See, the problem was, in this world, is because of the work of a great many spiritual adepts in the world that we were getting close to recognizing our arrogance, and actually it reached a high water point in the early 70s. Part of that was the Tibetans were driven out of Tibet. And Tibetan culture had maybe the highest degree of clarity as a cultural clarity. And because of their isolation and the intense efforts they had focused on spiritual enlightenment, path of enlightenment, this got driven out and spread out throughout the world. The Tibetans had to flee Tibet. That was, in the mid-1950s. And that gave a very powerful jolt to the world, spiritual jolt. Now, also, you had Ramana Maharshi, he passed away in 1950, but you had him giving that his influence was starting to spread very strongly. You had like books like The Razor's Edge that, you know, then Paul Brunt and various authors were writing about meeting this great adept, and his influence was starting to really resonate throughout the world. And after he passed away, even more so, he said, actually, my influence, his presence was even more potent. You had Ananda Maima, whose presence was being powerfully felt in the background. She was very elusive. Nobody could find where she was. She moved around, constantly moved around, so very difficult to find her. But people knew there's some super guru in India, this lady, but they'd say, well, yeah, but good luck finding her. It's extremely difficult. She wouldn't let any of that on. When she'd leave a place, she wouldn't let on where she was going. So she'd leave with like just a couple companions and just disappear into the vastness of India subcontinent, you know. Nobody knew where she was going. So you might find out where she had been, and you go to these people and say, yeah, Mom was just here last week. I said, well, where'd she go? She said, nobody knows. We don't know. But she was, like a super, super guru, an avatar, who was creating an enormous spiritual resonance in the world. Even the gurus would meet her. They'd say, oh my God, what is this? I've never seen anything like this. Shook them up. Gave them a tremendous wow. And then they radiated that wow out to all their, you know, all those who came to see them. So what she would visit all these different gurus and sages all over India and give them a tremendous boost, you know, a shock treatment, basically. Basically, she was engaged in spiritual shock treatment. And then also all the devotees of these gurus all over India would come to the, and they would get the shock that their own teachers had gotten. It would sort of be transmitted to them too. So they were lifted up that way too. And the Western world started to catch hold of this, you know, all of this, and there was a lot of revivalist movements in Christianity too taking place, of direct experiencing of Jesus, of the presence of Jesus. Then there was the Hare Krishna movement also, which was very strong, which was trying to go towards direct experiencing. So there were just all sorts of very powerful. The Zen movement was very strong, coming into West Coast of the United States, and Europe, and spreading throughout the world. And we reached a high water point at in 1970, the mid 1970s. And what happened then is, collectively, there was this will to recognize our arrogance. Okay. And we were just about ready to do so. We were right on the doorstep of saying, we can do this. And then the voice of our laziness and familiarity spoke up. I very clearly remember this tipping point that we had in the mid-70s. And I've said before, there was a book written about this woman in the encounter group, and what happened in the encounter group, where it split into two factions. Those who said, we can do it, and we're going to do it, and those says, no, it's too difficult. Let's back away from this. If we ever recognize our arrogance, we'll never be able to forgive ourselves. You know that. So that's what happened. And then, so those who's backed away and said, whoa, wait a minute, we're going to hate ourselves, and we'll be hated. And if we recognize our arrogance, that's just, we've been not doing nothing but sheer arrogance all this time. That's it. And camouflaging it. And so they decided then to completely reverse course and support this new world order, cosmic corporate culture takeover. And they began falsifying academia and scientific reports, and very sleazy lies, spreading this, frantically spreading lies. Their whole lives became lies. They decided that to tell the big lie was safer than to recognize their arrogance. This is what happened in the world. I lived through it. And ever since then, it's been real tough. That's actually when Ananda Mai Ma started sort of fading out of the picture too, in the mid-70s. She passed away in 1982. But in the early to mid-70s, she sort of seemed to lose her luster. Why? Because we as a planet decided that we're going to be lazy. And therefore, that's what we took her to be. Someone who would help our laziness. You see, she said, I am whatever you take me to be. And when we feel that we can do it, we can do this, then she took on this aura of this just unbelievably great spiritual presence, just total wowness. But when we decided to go back to the path of laziness, she seemed to lose her luster and become just a little old lady. And even now, like when I look at her picture, I don't see what I used to see at all. Not at all. It's when I first saw her picture, it was like 1997. That's when I first made her acquaintance and started studying her life. And at that point, I saw the spiritual luster, which was just like completely off the charts. But now, how was it 18 years later? What's happened in those 18 years since 1997? Well, the internet has happened. And smartphones has happened. And this takeover by cosmic corporate culture has happened. And so now when I look at her picture, it's just like, I don't see much of anything anymore. Just blah. Say, I don't see it. This shows you, you know, the attitude of the world. In other words, the world doesn't want to see true spirituality here. It wants to see laziness. It wants to be empowered to be lazy, essentially. We want to try and empower ourselves so we never recognize our arrogance. Which is impossible. That's a dead end. It's not possible. It's just a dead end. It's a waste of time. So what happened was those who freaked out and said, well, we're going to be hated. We're going to hate ourselves. We recognize arrogance. Not having the spiritual wisdom, you see. Not having the spiritual wisdom to recognize, no, we're going to love ourselves. To say, oh my God, what an incredible job he did camouflaging this arrogance all this time. Wow. I love that the creativity that I did. And we're not going to hate ourselves, but they thought they're going to hate themselves. And everybody would also hate them. And that's when Queen Beeism arose in this world, really, because the world was, those who wanted to be lazy were frantic to be reattracted to the world, and that's when the whole Queen Beeism diva complex really arose, called radical feminism, if you want, but it's really divaism, and these divas then actually psychically they called out for help in their to be greater divas of distraction, actually. And the help they got was from extraterrestrials, actually. Majority of their help. They also got a lot of help from corporations here who have also been getting help from extraterrestrials, from cosmic corporate culture, since the 40s. And some say even before that, but basically since the 40s, last 70 plus years. The divas, the ones who want to self-empowerment as divas to reattract to the world, they called out for help, help. They're desperate for help. And they were answered by extraterrestrials, actually. And these extraterrestrials have been helping them and helping this whole New World Order takeover, hostile takeover. And the divas don't realize, even to this now, even now, they don't realize they made a deal with the devil, so to speak. They're going to pay a very severe price for it, for sure. The whole world's paying a severe price for these divas. But again, the fear fed this. They said, oh my gosh, I just can't take the path. I'm going to be hated. Thinking we'll hate ourselves for what we did, just pursuing, doing nothing but sheer arrogance all this time. They said, I got to reinvest in making this world attractive. I just got to put my attention on making bodies attractive and the world attractive, all this, you know. And therefore, the way you do this is through divas, essentially. Feminism, radical feminism, and the diva culture that we have right now. That's how you reinvest your attention into the world. I mean, just ask yourself, what's more attractive, you know, female models and, you know, like fashion models on a catwalk or male models? Well, those are females. Even females will say that. I mean, the women just simply are able to make the body seem, look more attractive than men are. By far and away. By far and away. It's not even close. The way they make their hair, you know, just the whole styling and the attitude and the models. Female models are just extraordinarily creative. It's just amazing. Look at the magazines, how creative the mind is in the use of female bodies. Incredibly creative. Decorating them, dressing up, posing, attitude, just it seems like they're endlessly creative. And so this is what happened. We went back to diva culture. And it made it even, you know, blew it up, diva culture, making it, you know, on steroids, which literally is true. right? In order to make the world more attractive, birth control pills. See, birth control makes the world seem more attractive. You get all these wild women, wild diva women, you know, and people start saying, hey, you know, maybe this world can be I thought it was a terrible place, but maybe it's not so bad. Maybe I want to reinvest in it, you know. And so, this is what happened. This is what has happened in the world. It's already water under the bridge. We're living the consequences of that split that took place in the 70s. Now, I realized that and said, wow, this is bad news. I need help, 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 help. I got what help? A Course in Miracles came, A Course in Miracles. This was in response to our cries for help and also foresight, realizing this would happen. And so I was able to get into A Course in Miracles starting in 1978, but I knew that it was there. I was somehow psychically aware that A Course in Miracles was available in the world even before I found it in a bookstore. And so I was already preparing myself. I said, no, I'm going to go for a liberation. And did that up until 1997, really. But then I felt like I couldn't quite make it because the diva culture was so strong. I feel I'm going to be ostracized and stigmatized and marginalized and demonized. And, you know, so I said, nobody's going to, I mean, if someone was enlightened in the 70s, they draw a lot of attention. Nowadays, you know, you're not going to draw, I don't think you're going to draw much attention at all unless you play ball with the divas, really. Diva culture, you kind of play footsie with diva culture. So I said, wow, maybe it's just not going to work out. And then I started going back into music more, getting back into that and into diva culture, and called upon the goddess, you know, to help out. And she certainly did help out and direct me towards diva culture and says, yeah, you can help be a great force to make diva culture seem sort of spiritualize it. To spiritualize diva culture is what they told my role was to be. And so I was very much got into that and seeing how I could do that to at least give at least some spiritual taste, you know, some icing on the diva cake, the diva culture cake. But then I began to become very aware, more and more aware of the cosmic corporate culture, who is actually the puppet masters who are pulling the strings and the very devious culture that they have for us, which is this robotic, cyborg, artificial intelligence culture. I began, the Holy Spirit began showing me all of this, what's going on. I said, whoa, I think I need to get away from that goddess and diva culture. And ultimately was able to loop back into spiritual path again, being wiser for the difficulties I experienced, being able to, I kind of went along with diva, wanted to see what's really going on. So I got firsthand experience of what's really going on. I played along with it to a certain extent. I played along with it as a way of trying to get free of it, or how can I overcome this? You know, I really wanted to know what's really going on here. And so I played along with it for a while, and then I realized I got to stop playing. That's enough. This is really nasty stuff. Diva culture is very nasty stuff, built on lies and deceptions, camouflage. All their entitlement that they're projecting now is all completely bogus. It's so bogus. It's just pathetic. Pathetic. This entitlement, you know, self-empowerment, entitlement stuff. It's all based on all so many lies. Just a vast ocean of lies, actually, is really what it's based on. But who cares, right? Because the world, when you want to camouflage your arrogance, who cares if you're lying? They don't care. This is what's so mind-blowing. They seem to have no conscience about lying and deceiving. What do they care? Their whole purpose is to camouflage arrogance. And so what better way to camouflage arrogance than just to lie, 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 like it's nothing? Instead of saying, wait a minute, that's awfully arrogant to be trying to pass off this lie. Of course I'm going to be found out it's a lie. What am I doing? This is arrogance. No, what better way to camouflage arrogance than to say that lies are true? And if they're true, where's the arrogance? So when you double down, as what they did, they double down. They're trying to make lies true. They say, no, lies are now true. Lies are true. We're here to tell you we're totally competent. We're in charge. We're competent. They're not competent. This world is falling into this vast pit of incompetence. It's like replacing these session players with some garage band or something. I mean, these session players, studio session players, say, we're entitled now, it's our turn, get out of the way, we're not going to cut these records. So you listen to music and you say, wow, that's terrible. Who are these incompetent musicians? And they say, how dare you? You know, we're totally competent. The music we're giving you is wonderful music. And then it's like, wait a minute, I remember. No, he's not comparing, saying, no, you're lying. You're not competent. You're hacks. You're hacks. But this whole thing about self-empowerment is supposed to put, you know, people who are these divas in charge of everything now. I mean, every day you look up and some new diva is being put in charge of your life, your future. It's exactly what it is. They're hacks. They're hacks. We're not getting the best. See, studio musicians are the best of the best of the best. They get out and they have this great genius of getting out of their own way, allowing the song to emerge. Hacks are on ego trips based on trying to camouflage their arrogance, and they get in their own way. So what's happening is all these divas are being put in positions of power now over your life and the future of this planet. And they're on ego trips. They're all on ego trips, and they will get in their own way so severely. Just like this hack of a president we have right now. He's on an ego trip. He gets in his own way severely. Severely. And what does he do? He puts in other ego tripping divas all over. He cannot put anyone in any position unless they're a diva hack, ego trip. It's a disaster for the planet. Is it? And we're told, oh, the world is getting so much better. That's like being told that this song that these hacks have produced is better than before. And I said, I listened to it. I said, wait a minute. It's like a million times worse. They're completely in their own way. They're obscuring the song. They're not revealing it. They're obscuring it. And so, but we're told that everything's getting better. Everything's getting better. We're entering a golden age. Right. The golden age of what? Self-delusion. If you want to call that a golden age, I don't call that a golden age. Golden age of camouflage. Where we're reaching higher, greater heights of camouflaging our arrogance. And we're being reattracted to the world by this diva culture. This diva princess culture is unbelievable. You run into it now in your work. The diva says, do this, 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 this is what I want, this is what I want. And then when you do all this work and do what she wants, she says, well, that's not self-empowering enough. I need to empower myself more. No, I want it different. I want it different. Do it different. You do it different. And then she goes, nah, it's still not. Do it different. Of course, all the while, trying to hold you to the original budget that was designed just for this first, what she said she wanted. But keep change. But then you're supposed to do it on original budget. So you become overworked, underpaid, slave, essentially. You become a slave. Serving. When you serve diva culture, you become a slave. Plain and simple. Especially the men. The men are being enslaved on this planet. There's no question about it. I've already been through the whole thing. I see what the diva cult, what they do. They enslave you. They expect you to work for free. And then they throw you in the gutter. Throw you in the garbage dump. And never look back. And they feel that they're entitled to it. They're entitled because they're disguising their arrogance. They say, no, I'm not being arrogant. What they want is to make lies true. And then once they do that, they can say, well, I was never arrogant. See? I don't have to admit my arrogance. I don't have to repent because I was never arrogant. I was able to make lies true. I told you I can make lies true, and I have. You know, this is it. So that's the goal. When you go in the wrong direction, that's the goal, is you're working to make lies true so you can claim you were never arrogant and you don't need to repent. Very simple, very plain and simple. But we're on the path of repenting and saying, oh no, this has all been about my arrogance. It's been about anything other than that. Never. It's never been about anything other than my own arrogance. And look how creative I've been. Wow. Awesome creativity to camouflage this. And then it's easy then to segue, to have continuity between your feeling of just like awesome creativity and then to then segue right into the flow of no arrogance at all, you know, just dropping the arrogance because we have full confidence in our creativity. So we need to recognize this. We're not going to hate ourselves. In fact, we're going to love ourselves more than we've ever thought possible. We say, wow, aren't we absolutely fantastic that we camouflage sheer arrogance this whole time, making us think it's about the universe, about worlds, about bodies, about relationships, about people, about progress, about all this stuff, and things, and nature, and it was all just a camouflage for sheer arrogance, nothing more than that. Wow. Have a good laugh, for sure. At least we'll have a good laugh about it. We're not going to get angry at ourselves or hate ourselves or anything like that. That's the big mistake that they made back in the 70s. Psychoanalysis wasn't good enough. It doesn't have the wisdom in it. And a lot of these people involved in all this were, you know, heavily into therapy and self-analysis, and they panicked. They panicked when they saw, they glimpsed the truth, their arrogance, they panicked. I'm telling you, plain and simple, this is what happened. This is all that happened. They glimpsed their own arrogance, the arrogance, the sheer arrogance, and they panicked. And they said, no, we got to make lies true. We can never admit to this. And this is the result. Our culture right now is the result of that. It's a culture of just incredibly sheer arrogance being unrecognized, tremendous efforts to camouflage it and to hide it. So what better way to hide it than practice what these divas is? They say, I'm so competent, I'm so competent, I'm so wonderful. And you say, oh yeah, sure you are, yes, you're great. You know, someone like, you know, never played a piano in the day, they take, oh, I want to be a session piano player. Okay, what do I need to do? Oh, I need to take lessons. How many lessons? Well, I don't have much time, so I'll take lessons for about a week. Okay, and so they take a week's lessons. They can't play at all. They complete hacks. And then they go in and say, "Okay, I'm here. I'm the new session piano player here. Guys, get out. I'm here now. Diva's here." And then she plays this and just hideous, can't play at all. And then they cut a record. And I'm a star. Look at this record. People say, really? Says, yeah, isn't it wonderful? Isn't it empowering? And you'd say, oh, yeah, yeah, it is. It is. I love the music. You're wonderful. You're incredible. You're this incredible diva. You're so attractive. In fact, you make the whole world seem so attractive to me. This is the mind screwing that's going on right now, big time. This is what happens when you decide to work on camouflaging your arrogance, trying to make truth lies. I mean, trying to make lies truth, or either way, but you're trying to make lies true. And so you can claim, I was never arrogant. You see the two different paths, the two different directions? One goes to say, I was never arrogant. The other says, oh yes, God, I've been nothing but arrogant in this whole endeavor here. It was completely sheer arrogance and nothing else. I repent. I recognize, I repent, and I recognize my creativity has only been involved with that. Now I'm putting my creativity back to what you really designed me for, you know, which is glory, 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 glory. That's the path of salvation. The other path of trying to make lies true so we can claim we were never arrogant is the path of hell, is a hellish path of suffering, path of slavery, path of self-deception, path of constantly trying to deceive yourself and believing in lies, believing that these stale crumbs are, you know, are wonderful. This is better than anything you could possibly imagine. And it's horrible. Those are the two different directions. Those are the two different directions. Plain and simple. It's cut and dried. So this diva path that the world is on is terrible. You know, I'm warning you, I'm saying, I'm pointing it out. I mean, you will regret it. You will really regret it. And backing out of it is very tough. It's doable, I've done it. I played along just to see, is it possible to back out of it? Yes, it is. Yes, it is. And then you have regrets. I mean, you really steamed at yourself, you know. Wow, what an idiot. You know, I just feel like, how could I do that? How could I go along with such deception? Wow, it's tough to back out of it, but you can do it, and you have to do it. I'm aware, directly that you can do it, but you can make it tough on yourself. There's no question about it. And you think, oh, that's no problem because I'll be so creative, I'll be able to make lies true, and then I don't have any arrogance and nothing to back out of, and it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. It never works that way. You can never be more creative than God. So you can never make lies true. So you will have to back out of all of this. There's no way around it. No way around it whatsoever. So you got the full expression here on this video, as I try to do. I try to, you know, lay it all out there, you know, just so you can bring it to light, the totality, bring it to light, and just, you know, recognize and say, hey, yeah, let's keep on the path of repentance here. Let's stay on the path of repentance here. In fact, let's finish this past. Let's get our healed perception. Let's recognize, oh, I didn't do anything except it's just been sheer arrogance. I didn't fix anything. I didn't reveal anything. I didn't do anything. It's been nothing but camouflaging. Arrogance is all I've done. I don't, as far as reality is concerned, it's untouched. I never touched it. Never touched it. Nothing's been fixed. Nothing's been plugged. Just abide in that seeing. Abide in that seeing. Oh, I don't need to do anything. I don't need to do anything. Nothing's been done. There's no trace that an I was ever here. There's no trace that a self was ever here. There's no trace of a self in reality. No trace of an I in reality. No trace of it whatsoever. None. And just abide in that recognition. Keep, you know, go towards that and abide in it. And this is what's called true repentance. And this will then enables you to set your arrogance down once and for all and be done with it. And what was our arrogance? Our arrogance was claiming that we want to be greater than God. Oh, we see a flaw in you, God. You're not perfect, God. That's arrogance, claiming that we see imperfection. And then claiming that we made a deal with God where we'll back off our seeing imperfection if God backs off perfection. And then believing there's some middle ground, that there's this new reality now, which opens up the possibility for us to become perfect, like a competition between God and us. And it's really like a deal, like there's a competition where God can pull us into an abyss and annihilate us, or we can grow and become perfect, greater than God. That's some sort of deal that God is bound by. This is sheer arrogance. God never accepted any deal. God can never accept any deal. Perfection never can accept any deal. There's no such thing as a deal to perfection. Perfection remains perfect always. So it's sheer arrogance to suggest that such a deal was made. But we believe it was made, and so we're frantically working to become perfect and camouflage our arrogance and believe that there is this competition between us and God, and also sort of a mutual deal where we both also agree to follow our part of the deal, you know, and give it time. And if we have all these parameters, I think that we made a deal, that we work within these parameters. We have to keep our part of the deal bargain. God has to keep its part of the bargain, so we can give this time to just find out who is better, who's greater, you know. But it's unlimited time, really. It's time. We give it time. The time came into this deal. We said, yeah, there's something called time. And as long as time is still going, you know, we have to both abide by our, it hasn't been decided, the issue hasn't been decided yet, who's greater. Who's primary? So sheer arrogance. No deal's ever been made. There's no such thing as time. God never recognized time at all. That's part of a deal. God never made any deal. Eternity didn't make a deal with time. Everywhereness didn't make any deal with place. Freedom didn't make any deal with circumstance, situation, process. There's no deal at all in place. This is all our imagination. It's a camouflage of our arrogance is all it is. The notion that a deal is in place. It's just all camouflaging our arrogance. So again, we either take the path of repentance, or we keep trying to camouflage our arrogance, trying to become greater than God. We'll be stuck with time, space, process, and form. And we think if we succeed, then no arrogance. That's the path of self-deception, path of folly, path of stupidity. And the world is hell-bent on going down that path. But continue your being the studio, spiritual studio player here. Keep laying down these hits. Keep getting out of your own way more and more and more. And you won't go down that path. You will repent. You will see the perfection of the now, the timeless, of timelessness, perfection of timelessness. You'll drop the deal. You say, I don't have to keep believing in the deal because there is no deal. I don't have to keep believing in time, space, process, and form. There's no deal. I don't have to keep trying to compete with God and try to become greater than God. So we don't have to see that. See the flawlessness of the effortless flawlessness of now, and no trace of any effort being ever employed to make it so. No trace. And just see this and abide in this. And this will ultimately then bring us to the final step which God takes for us, which is knowing. But our goal is this healed perception. So continue to get out of your own way. Continue to get out of your own way here. This is what we do in these videos, like a session here, recording session. Get out of your own way. Get out of your own way. So we're about to come across the end of this video here. Nice. You know, it's always, it seems like the same length of time. Was it 2:31:09 or something like that it goes? This is a good, strong session that we put in. It's like cutting a hit. Cut a hit record and it's done. We've done it. So I feel this is another hit video. The last three or four videos I've done, I feel they're really hit videos. Although most of them I feel are hit videos, especially the more recent ones. But they're very strong and potent, and you might feel a backlash from that. I've experienced extreme backlash from it. It's like shock. It's like, whoa, you know, are we really ready for this? Are we going to be angry at ourselves? No, we're not going to be angry at ourselves. Was Ramana Maharshi angry with himself? Not at all. We're not going to be angry at ourselves. We're going to love ourselves. We say, forgive ourselves. Say, gosh, all along it was nothing but sheer arrogance. What an incredible creativity it was to...